Many of you know John from his preaching. He was the teaching pastor for the Willow Creek Community Church in Chicago, and is now the senior pastor for Menlo Park Presbyterian Church in the Bay Area. Some of you know John from his many books, including Who Is This Man? A book he wrote that's having great influence because it makes the claim that not only has Christianity not been bad for the world, but it's been good. That wherever the story of Jesus has gone, people have been blessed. The poor have been reached. Orphans have been taken care of. And some of you may be thinking, that's funny, we had a sermon series on that at our own church recently. Well, that's because we've all read John's book and been blessed by it. Most recently, he's coming out with a book just this past week called Soul Keeping, in which he continues this work of spiritual formation. For many of us, John has been a popularizer of some of the amazing material of his dear friend Dallas Willard. We've been the beneficiaries of their connection. As you probably know, Dallas died about a year ago. John carries on and works with the Dallas Willard Foundation. So there are a lot of contexts that you know him. He's an amazing preacher, a great thinker. He and Nancy have three grown children. He's on the Board of Trustees for Fuller Theological Seminary. But we are especially glad to have John Ortberg with us today. Would you welcome him to the stage?
Well, good afternoon, everybody. I am super honored to be here for a whole bunch of reasons. The first church that I ever worked at full-time was Simi Valley Community Church, just a few miles away from here. So it brings back a lot of wonderful memories, and somebody from Simi Valley. That's super cool. There's a guy named Mark Scarberry who is actually in... Mark, is that you? Oh my gosh, Mark Scarberry is sitting up there who teaches law here at Pepperdine. And Suzanne, gosh, it's good to see you. Can you all talk to each other for a while? I'm going to go see Mark. You look just the same. It's amazing. The church where I now serve in Menlo Park, many, many families have young folks that go to school at Pepperdine. So there's that connection. I'm here with F. Martin, who's a really good friend, and he's on the board at Pepperdine. So that's a great connection. A guy by the name of David Davenport now lives in the Bay Area and kind of sneaks over, even though we're a Presbyterian church sometimes, to see how we're doing. And I'm very honored because I know something about the history of these Bible lectures. I actually went online and saw last year when Rick Warren was unable, you know, due to a very serious deal, to be here, and Max Licato said yes. And I thought Mike was so gracious to let everybody know that he didn't want anybody to think that Max was the second choice. Some of you remember that? So he told everybody he had actually asked Max initially to speak last year, way in advance, and because of his book schedule, Max couldn't do it. And then he asked him like 18 months in advance for the following year, and Max couldn't do that. And I thought that was very gracious till I realized that the following year, for which Max was the first choice, was this year. 2014. And so I did a little research, and when Max said no, it turns out that Mike also asked Tim Keller, Bill Hybels, Francis Chan, Erwin McManus, Chuck Swindoll, Rob Bell, John Piper, N.T. Wright, several dead guys, and the guy who wrote Our God is an Awesome God, and all of them said no. So I'm not quite as honored as I thought I was, but I'm still like honored to be here. And I thought since this is a series on the Bible, that I'd like to talk for a while about the central message of the Bible, and particularly the way that it was illumined for so many of us by this man that Mike mentioned, Dallas Willard. It is a message that's increasingly lost because we live in a world where people just don't know the story of the Bible anymore. I was on a flight not real long ago, and I was sitting next to a guy from the Bay Area, and we talked for about an hour, and it was real clear as we talked that he was an unchurched guy. And the longer we talked, the clearer it was, the more unchurched that it was apparent that he was. And finally, after about an hour, he asked me, and this, those of you who are pastors know this question inevitably comes up, what do you do? And I said, well, I'm a pastor. It's just a true story. And he said, I'll be damned. And I said, well, I hope not, but let's talk about that for a while, because that's a real important subject. And I want to talk about how there are words, real important words, like heaven or salvation or faith or trust, trusting in Jesus or gospel, that I believe are many of the most important words and ideas in the human vocabulary, but they're largely not understood. And what's even worse, in our culture, we don't know that we don't know. We don't understand what it is that we don't understand. People think they know what words like gospel mean, and so they may dismiss them without ever realizing, without ever connecting them to these transcendent truths behind them. This has always been a problem. Words always tend to lose their meaning like that, and the most important person in helping me understand them was a man who just lived a few miles away from here and died almost exactly a year ago, May 8th, Dallas Willard. And so much of what I want to talk about will be ideas that I first heard or learned about from Dallas. And I want to start with a question that Dallas posed for me and some other folks many, many years ago. And if you want to, if you're up for it, I'll actually ask you to turn to one or two people around you and take a shot at answering this question. But the question is this: what is the gospel or the good news that Jesus came to preach? That word gospel is a real important word, and you know, we'll hear it attached to phrases like gospel songs or gospel music or so on. But if Jesus were saying to a group of people, "I want to tell you now the good news, I want to tell you the gospel," what would come next? What is the gospel that Jesus himself proclaimed? And if you don't mind, just take a, 30 or 60 seconds, turn to one or two people around you, take a shot at answering that question. What's the gospel that Jesus came to teach? Okay, I'm going to bring that conversation to a close right now. And it sounds like a real simple question, but I can tell you, at least from my experience, that a whole lot of folks, including a whole lot of folks in a whole lot of churches in our country, will not give the same answer to this question that we actually find in the Bible, in those books that we call the Gospels. So I want to read a few passages. First, from the Gospel of Mark. Mark and Luke and Matthew have very similar summaries of Jesus' message. This is Mark 1, 14 and 15. After John was put into prison, Jesus went into Galilee proclaiming the good news, or the gospel, of God. "The time has come," he said. "The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news." After John was put in prison, Jesus went to Galilee proclaiming the good news of God. "Time has come," he said, "the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news." And very similar summaries are given at the beginning of Matthew and at the beginning of Luke. Now, once Jesus chose his disciples, he adopted a kind of a strategy to communicate this message to everybody he could. So Luke 8:1, if you have your Bibles or you're taking notes, you want to look later on. We're told after this, Jesus traveled about from one town to another after he chose his disciples, proclaiming the good news, the euangelion, the gospel of the kingdom of God. And then in the next chapter, when Jesus sent his disciples out, he sent them to proclaim one message. Luke chapter 9, when Jesus had called the 12 together, he gave them power and authority to drive out all demons and to cure diseases, and he sent them out to preach the kingdom of God. After Jesus was crucified and rose from the dead, he spoke to the disciples about one topic, Acts chapter 1, verse 3. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. And then the last glimpse we have of the early church in the book of Acts, the last verse of the last chapter, Paul is proclaiming one truth. This is Acts 28, verse 31. Boldly and without hindrance, he proclaimed the kingdom of God. Now, if you're going to say what Jesus' gospel is about in one phrase, what do you think that one phrase might be? The kingdom of God. Jesus' good news, his gospel, is simply this: that the kingdom of God, and we'll come back to what that means, the kingdom of God through Jesus has in some way now become uniquely, newly available for ordinary human beings to live in. And it's right here, right now. And you can walk right into it if you want to. And here's something I believe to be desperately tragic, at least in the kind of churches that I grew up in and have been around most of my life. Thousands of churches and millions of Christians in our day have substituted another gospel for this. And this other gospel that has been substituted for Jesus' gospel might be put like this. People think the gospel means here are the minimal entrance requirements for getting into heaven when you die. Now, we don't usually put it exactly like that. But there's tons of people in churches, and what they understand the gospel to be is, they understand the gospel to be the proclamation of, here's the minimal entrance requirements, the minimum amount of stuff that you have to believe so that when you die, they have to let you into heaven. A lot of people have reduced the gospel to this notion that when you die, there'll be kind of this ramp to the other side, and the gospel is the secret answer to the correct question. I will sometimes use a picture for this, and I'm sure nobody, this involves an old movie, nobody from a Church of Christ will ever have seen this movie, but it's called Monty Python and the Holy Grail. Wow. I feel like I'm talking to a bunch of Episcopalians. Anyway, if you've ever seen or heard of that movie, there's a scene towards the end of it when Arthur and some of his knights are on a quest for the Holy Grail, and there's a castle, and they think the Grail is there, but there's a chasm between where they are and the castle, and there's one bridge to get to it. And in order to be able to cross that bridge, there's this weird, wizened old bridge keeper, and they have to give the correct answer to three questions. And if they get them right, they can cross the bridge, but if they get the answers wrong, they are cast down into the abyss. So the stakes are very high. The first knight comes up and he's asked, state your name, he does. State your quest, he does. Then he's asked, what's your favorite color? Red. And he gets to cross over to the castle to fulfill his quest. So the second knight comes up and he's quite cocky now. What's your name? He gives it. What's your quest? He gives it. And then he's asked this really obscure question, like who won the World Cup in 1948, something like that. He says, I don't know. Ah, and he's cast down into the abyss. So now the third knight is quite nervous. State your name, he does. What's your quest, he does. And he's asked, what's your favorite color? But he's so nervous, he says, red. No, blue. Ah, and he's cast out of the abyss. And now there's just Arthur. He's asked, what's your name? Arthur, King of the Britons. What's your quest? Search for the Holy Grail. And then he's asked a question, been a running gag through the whole movie. Some of you will know. What's the airspeed velocity of a coconut-laden swallow? And his answer also is a running gag. Well, that depends. Is it an African swallow or a European swallow? And the bridge keeper says, I don't know the answer to that. Ah, and the bridge keeper is cast down in the abyss. Now, many people have reduced the gospel to this, that when you die, there will be this ramp to the other side, to the castle, to the pleasure factory where everybody wants to go. And the gospel is the secret answer to that question, which if you give it, means they have to let you cross. They think of the gospel as the proclamation of the minimal entrance requirements for getting into heaven when you die. Here's the problem with that. Where in the New Testament does Jesus ever say, now I'm going to give you the minimal entrance requirements for getting into heaven when you die? Where does Jesus ever say that? He never says that. He never says anything remotely like that. What he says is, this is kind of a paraphrase from Dallas, now all the preliminaries have been taken care of, and the kingdom of God has been made available to absolutely anybody who wants it. So you review your plans for living and you rearrange your life based on this extraordinary offer. Now, of course, Jesus' gospel includes the forgiveness of our sins as a free gift of grace that we could never merit. Of course, Jesus' gospel includes the promise that death will not have the last word, that our eternal life with God will never ever cease. But it includes more than that. Jesus came as the kingdom bringer. The kingdom somehow was now present in Jesus' very body, in his life and his words. A lot of people think the only real reason Jesus came to earth was to die on the cross. But his death on the cross was actually just one part of his mission. His overall mission was to be the kingdom bearer, the kingdom bringer. In Matthew 6, he's talking to people who believe in God, but they're just frittering their life away on the same stuff that everybody else does. What am I going to eat or drink or wear? What kind of job will I get? How much money am I going to make? How big a house can I afford? By the way, how many of you do not live in Malibu? Anybody experience any house envy when you come out to a place like this? This is unbelievable. Can you believe they like pay people to work at a school like this? Holy smokes. Well, anyhow, Jesus teaches about this stuff because it's just human nature. And then at Matthew 6, 32, verse 33, he says, you know, I wouldn't worry about all this stuff, for the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows you need them. But seek first the kingdom of God. Seek that first. Seek it above everything else. Seek it more than anything else. And his righteousness. And all these other things will be added, will be given. God knows you need them. But seek first this. Now, this was quite extraordinary for me to realize. Jesus' one gospel was the gospel of the availability of the kingdom. His one purpose was to model, to manifest the reality of that kingdom in his life, in his words, in his death, in his resurrection. His one command was to pursue the kingdom, seek first the kingdom of God. His one plan was for his people to extend the kingdom. The end of the book of Acts, boldly and without hindrance, Paul proclaims the kingdom of God. And yet, millions of people who named the name of Jesus could not tell you what the kingdom is. So I thought at the Pepperdine Bible lectures, what a wonderful time to just talk a little bit about what the central message of the gospel of Jesus is about. So let's talk for a few moments about the kingdom. Part of the problem in talking about the kingdom is in his day, that was a concept, it was a picture, it was a reality that everybody was very familiar with, but it's not for us. We don't have kings or kingdoms where we live. So let's talk about what a kingdom is. And I'll start with this. Everybody has a kingdom, as the Bible is talking about kingdom. Everybody has a kingdom in a biblical sense. Your kingdom is that little sphere in which what you say goes. To use Dallas's phrase for it, your kingdom is the range of your effective will. The range of your effective will. It is where what you want to have happen happens. Okay? Kingdom is the range of your effective will. People learn early on that they were made to have a kingdom. It is why we do not like to be told what to do. What is a two-year-old's favorite word? No. What's a two-year-old's second favorite word? Mine. Those are kingdom words. A two-year-old is learning they have a kingdom. Often parents don't like it when two-year-olds learn that they have their own little kingdom. They become more trouble. But it's a real good thing because you were made to have a kingdom. It's part of what it means to be a person. See, this is all core to what personhood is. And Jesus understands about this. And these teachings, these claims must be understood. And they must be laid alongside of whatever other understandings of personhood or human life are popular in any age, including our own. They just got to be laid out. We live in a day where the dominant thought of human beings is that they are not persons in this sense, and they do not have a kingdom in this sense, and we're no longer even sure if they have a will in this sense, or if they're just the product of causes, see? But they're not just the product of causes. Little two-year-olds learn they have a kingdom. Little kids in the back seat of a car draw a line, and they say to the other kids next to them in the back seat of the car, you better not cross over this line. Why? Because this is my kingdom. And they start defending their kingdoms. And after a while, dad turns around, because whose kingdom does dad think the car is? He thinks it's his kingdom, and he will actually ask them, do you want me to come back there? And the kids are thinking, sure, you're going to come back here while the car is doing like 65 miles an hour down the expressway. So dad sends Mr. Hand back like a snake, and the kids retreat to the corners of the seat. Ken Davis has advice on how to get them out of the unreachable safety zone. He says a tap on the brakes brings them right into play. Thy kingdom comes. Okay? My kingdom is the range of my effective will. That is, where things go the way that I want them to go. And having a kingdom is a real good thing. It's part of what God made you for. It's way back to the beginning of Genesis. Now, Jesus is just bringing all of this together. Genesis 1:26, then God said, let us make human beings in our own image according to our likeness and let them have dominion. Is a great old word. Let them have dominion. See, that's kingdom language way back in Genesis 1. It's part of being made in the image of God. And by the way, that's part of why it's so difficult to lead people without violating the image of God in them. And that's why when someone is in leadership over you, politically or at a job or something, I was just talking with Gary about teaching on communication and leadership. How difficult is it to use words to try to lead someone without violating their kingdom? And we feel that with such great sensitivity. Someone tries to coerce you or intimidate you or control you. My wife's a very feisty character, and sometimes at night when we're in bed, I will say to her, Nancy, I command you to turn out the light. And she will not turn out the light just because she is not going to do anything that I have commanded her to do. That light is on all night long sometimes just because I'm not going to take it back and she's not going to do it. See, that's what it means to have a kingdom. You're made to have a kingdom and to honor and cherish somebody else. That's why Jesus said so much about leadership in the category of warning, because it's so hard to lead somebody without violating their kingdom. And all is terribly important to the world in which we live and how we arrange our lives. And the teachings of Jesus must be understood and laid alongside of every other system of thought so that folks can just judge clearly who's right, who makes sense of it all. Now, part of the problem for us is our kingdoms are all junked up by sin. On earth, all these little kingdoms intersect and merge and they form larger kingdoms, like schools. So Pepperdine, that's a kingdom. Neighborhoods, cities, corporations, nations. These are all economic and political and cultural systems. Kingdoms are systems of personal power. Okay, that's what a kingdom is. A kingdom is a system of personal power. That's a kingdom. And there's all of these kingdoms, and we could call this whole conglomeration, you and your family and your neighborhood and your church and Pepperdine and the United States, and we could call all of that, if we wanted to use biblical language for it, the kingdom of earth. Okay, so the kingdom of earth. Let's do a contrast study for a moment. Jesus says that there is another domain. It is spiritual, it is real, and it is, in the Bible, what's talked about as the kingdom of God. That's the range of God's effective will. That's wherever God's will is being done. That's the sphere in which everything that happens meets with God's approval and God's delight and God's celebration. Everything is just the way that God wants it to be. That's the kingdom of God, and it's real. And it's why Jesus spends more time talking about this and what it's like than anything else. He says, whoever humbles himself like a little child is the greatest in the kingdom of God. That's Matthew 18. Or in Luke 14, and again, you might just look this all up. Luke 14, great passage on the kingdom of God. Kingdom of God is like a banquet to which the poor, the blind, the lame, the crippled all get invited. Or Romans 14, Paul says, the kingdom of God is not a matter of legalistic rules about what you eat or drink, but a matter of righteousness, peace, and joy. Imagine a society where there is no pride or arrogance, no big shots, just a spirit of servanthood and humility. Imagine a society where people are constantly on the lookout for anybody who might feel lonely or rejected, and they get included and celebrated and loved. Imagine a society where nobody does anything petty or small-minded. There's no gossip. There's no cruelty. There's no fear. And watching over all of this as its greatest inhabitant and primary sustainer is the Heavenly Father of Jesus, who is endlessly celebrated for his infinite love. Now, Jesus says, this is the kingdom of God, and it's real, and it exists right now. Then, there's this other domain called the kingdom of the earth. Question for everybody. How are things going in the kingdom of the earth? Not so well. Just turn on your computer. Syrian refugees by the hundreds of thousands that nobody knows what to do with. Volatility in the Ukraine that everybody's frightened about. Anybody follow the last couple of days what's going on with the owner of an NBA team called the Clippers? And that whole story is a train wreck on so many different levels. Just centuries of racial division that remain unhealed. Then how do we respond to that? How do I deal with the judgmentalism inside? I mean, just a mess. Thousands of little children dying every day that don't need to. Okay? That's the kingdom of the earth. And we get used to it. And I was just up at the beautiful monument up at the top of the campus here to the heroes of 911, and we remember that. And, you know, we're devastated when a crisis like that happens because it gets our attention. But, of course, thousands of people, that gets repeated hundreds of times every day, thousands of people dying, and we're just used to it. That's the kingdom of the earth. So Jesus had this plan. Jesus said, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to bring this up here down to this down there. I'm going to make up there come down here. And he expressed this in his most famous prayer that a lot of people don't think about much, and I never did either. I grew up saying the Lord's Prayer. Everybody here know the Lord's Prayer? A lot of people don't. A guy by the name of Ken Davis wrote about this. It's true as far as I know. Ken wrote about it. The Chicago Bears back in the 1980s had a great team. Anybody remember the Bears back in the 1980s? Walter Payton and Jim McMahon and the refrigerator, Fridge Perry. And the chaplain was having a meeting with them. And at one point, Mike Ditka asked the fridge to pray the Lord's Prayer for the whole team. And Jim McMahon, the quarterback, turned to the chaplain and said, there's no way that the fridge knows the Lord's Prayer. I will bet you $50 that Refrigerator Perry does not know the Lord's Prayer. And the chaplain thought, well, that's kind of an odd thing to wager on, but what the heck, might as well. So they bet $50 on it. Everybody bowed their head, closed their eyes, and the fridge began to pray. Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. Jim McMahon shook his head sadly, pulled $50 out of his pocket, handed it to the chaplain and said, man, I was sure he didn't know the Lord's Prayer. So, you all know the Lord's Prayer. I used to pray it all the time when I was growing up. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Prayer wasn't, God, get me out of here so I can go up there. A lot of Christians think that my job as a Christian primarily is to get my afterlife destination taken care of. A lot of people have shrunk the magnificent gospel of Jesus down into this odd little, make sure that you believe the right thing and can get the right answer out of your mouth so that your afterlife destination is taken care of. There's an old prayer. I don't know, anybody here ever watched a show called Star Trek? Remember when people would get in trouble in Star Trek, they would pray to a guy named Scotty what their request would be? Beam me up. Okay? A lot of people think that's kind of the Christian prayer. It's such a mess down here, God. Beam me up so I can get out of here and go up there. Jesus never said, pray, get me out of here so I can go up there. He said, God, pray, God, make up there come down here. My life, my home group, my church, my office, my school, my family, my neighborhood, my city, my country, my world. Jesus said, this is supposed to be the prayer. And we're taught to pray this, most of us, when we're real little kids. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth. In Malibu, California. Can you imagine Malibu, California, if up there came down here? What would that be like? Let me ask you a question. Do you think that that really might happen? Do you think Jesus was really serious when he told us to pray that prayer? Do you think that Jesus had thought it all out? See, this really does happen. It happened, first of all, in Jesus, in his body. When people saw his body, they experienced the kingdom of God on earth. Just the way that he was with people. The way he received people and loved people and blessed little children and told the truth. And then he would talk about, here's what life in the kingdom of God is like. And then his plan was for it to happen in you and in me, in our bodies. Begins in your body. So I'm going to say a little word about that one, because the coming of the kingdom of God now begins by the process of the transformation of human beings. The coming of the kingdom of God to earth begins with the transformation of you and you and you and you. And I'll say a little bit about that. Dallas, we talk a lot about a phrase that has become quite popular in our day, spiritual formation. Say a little bit word of what spiritual formation is about, because it's one of those words that is very often misunderstood in our day. And people think about spiritual formation as kind of an optional activity that certain folks in your church might be interested in. Okay? So a word about what spiritual formation is really about. And the simplest analogy I know is this, that there is an outer you. And that outer you, your body, is being formed or shaped all the time by what you eat, by what you don't eat, by how much sleep you get, by exercise. There's an outer you, and it's being formed or shaped all the time. And there is an inner you. You have a mind. You have a spirit. And that inner you is being formed or shaped all the time by the conversations that you have, by what you read, by what you watch on TV, by the people that you're with. Everybody is receiving a spiritual formation. Okay? It's terribly important because a lot of times in churches, people think about a spiritual formation as just this optional activity that introspective, introverted, Thomas Merton reading white males might be interested in. Okay? And then it gets marginalized. That is not the case. Every human being is receiving a spiritual formation all the time, whether they want to or not. It is non-optional. It is the only question is, do I pursue it intentionally or accidentally? And Jesus says, now, if you want to, I will be the one involved in spiritually transforming you. I will bring up there, down here, right into your body. And then I'll say a couple of words about kind of the process by which that happens, the way that it happens in a person, and then we got to wrap up. Dallas would often talk about the parts of a person that need to be transformed. So I want to say a little bit about that. As a person, right at the core of you, and this needs transforming, is your will. Okay, we all have a will. And your will is what makes decisions. You're able to choose. You're able to say yes or no. So we all got a will, but part of the problem right now is our wills do not line up perfectly with God's will, and that's why the kingdom of the earth is such a mess. And I'll just give you a real quick way of identifying that. Does anybody here have any bad habits? Anybody ever gossip, ever worry, ever do the wrong thing, ever self-promote, ever get judgmental, ever avoid confrontation, ever bend the truth to get out of trouble, ever hold on to a grudge, ever get cold and withdraw from somebody, ever have impure thoughts, ever get impatient with a three-year-old, ever get stubborn or defensive or passive-aggressive or closed-minded? Anybody, like mass confession, anybody ever have any of those? I'm a pastor. It took me about 30 seconds to come up with that list. Do you know why? Because my wife has done every single one of those things on that list. Okay? So I have a will, and then Dallas would say, beyond the will, the next layer out is you have a mind. And in the ancient world, generally, mind was understood to include both my thoughts, just that stream of consciousness that's going on inside me all the time, and the feelings that are associated with them. And every thought carries a little feeling with it. So my thoughts and my feelings are what constitute my mind, and what's going on in your mind, that's mostly your life. That's mostly my life. Our life is mostly what's going on in our minds. And I'd like to think that my mind is running the show and that my behavior is always reasonable and logical, but of course it is not. Just real simple example. One time I looked into my wallet for my credit card and it was gone. And I realized I had given it to my son and he had not returned it to me. And in my mind, I just instinctively start having all of these thoughts and they're just automatic. What's the matter with that kid? He ought to be more responsible. Credit card's a really important thing. He could lose it. It's just irritating that he wouldn't do that. And so I texted him, "You have my credit card?" And he texted back, "Yes." And then all of a sudden, I remembered, I forget stuff a lot. And I'm talking with Mike, I forgot my computer bag here today someplace on campus. I forget stuff all the time. And I don't get mad at me when I do that. And then I remembered that I had given Johnny the credit card to run an errand for me that he had not finished running yet. So like he had the credit card because I had asked him to do something for me. So I texted him back, but my second text was a lot different than the first one. I just texted him back, "I miss it." And he texted back to me, "I will help you forget it." Okay? See, that's our minds and our memories and our values and our conscience and our humors all there in our minds. And this is real important. You know, our minds, in order for us to live in the kingdom of God, our minds must be changed. That's why Romans 12, 1 and 2, one of the great passages about spiritual transformation. "I beseech you, brothers and sisters, based on the mercies of Christ, do not be conformed to this world," that is the kingdom of the earth, "but be transformed by the renewing of your mind." Okay. Now, our wills are real good at certain things. Our wills are very good at making big decisions, to get married, to go to Pepperdine, you know, choose a school or a vocation or move someplace. Our wills are very good at making large, concrete decisions. Our wills are terrible at overriding patterns that are habitual in our minds. This is part of the great weakness of much of like the self-help movement. People will say, when you wake up in the morning, you can just choose to have a great attitude. Well, no, you can't. And that gets largely to that next layer out, which is the body. Body's real important because your body is your little opportunity to have a kingdom on earth. My body is my little kingdom. It is the main place in the universe where my little will has a chance to be in charge. But my body is also full of all kinds of appetites and all kinds of habits. And lots of time, instead of my body obeying my will, when we get malformed, my will becomes enslaved to my body. And this is where addictions come. And where habits are so powerful. And then our minds and our values get violated. And then in the final layer out there, and I don't have time to get deeply into this, but I just wrote this book on soul keeping is the soul. The soul is what combines all of this together into a single whole person. And the soul was made to be connected with God. And when the soul, when the will is fractured and the mind isn't working right and the body is not working right, a soul can be lost. One of the greatest statements Jesus ever made is, what does it profit a person to gain the whole world but lose their... Now see, I used to think what that meant was, it doesn't do you any good to make a lot of money and have a lot of pleasure if you're going to go to hell. That's not what Jesus is saying. Of course, it doesn't do you any good to make a lot of money and have a lot of pleasure if you're going to hell. But that's not his point. You're not lost because you're going to the wrong place. You'll end up in the wrong place because you're lost. And when someone's will is hopelessly addicted to appetites in their body, and they're violating the values that they want to hold with their mind, and their mind is filled with deception of themselves, so they have to deceive themselves about who it is that they truly are, and they're betraying their own values, and they're having desires that conflict with each other and conflict with their values and conflict with their conscience. And then if I resent you, if I don't like you, I have to teach my face to try to pretend like it is not so. So now my body is at war with my mind and the thoughts that are going on inside me. Then I am disintegrated. See, the soul was made to integrate the will and the mind and the body together with God and God's creation and other people. And when that does not happen, sin always disintegrates the will and the mind and the body, and then you have a lost soul. And you don't have to believe the Bible to see this. Just look at Howard Hughes. Just look at Amy Winehouse. Just look at you and me. Jesus was making one of the most profound diagnostic statements ever offered to the human race. What does it profit a human being to gain the whole world if they lose their soul? The greatest opportunity ever offered the human race is to leave that train wreck, to step, to offer my body as a living sacrifice so that my mind can be renewed, so that my will can be saved, and my soul can be delivered. And then up there can come down here, and it happens right now. And I'll tell you one last statement about what a wonderful opportunity this is, and Dallas would often say this. Eternity, you know, we'll talk a lot about eternal life. What will it look like to enter into eternal life? Eternity is in session right now. Eternity is not something that you're going to enter into someday. Eternity is running right now, and you can step right into an eternal kind of life right now. I have a niece who got married a couple years ago, and it takes us such a long time to realize how fast time goes and why it is that times go so fast, because we were not made for time. We were made for eternity. You are an eternal being. And you hit a certain age, and I hit this some time ago, where it's like, it's amazing how much faster time keeps going. Anybody notice that? So my niece Courtney got married, and she and her husband were out on the dance floor, and they did this dance at one point where all the married couples were invited onto the dance floor, and then you had to leave the dance floor in reverse order of how long you've been married. So Courtney and her husband, and they're young and just this beautiful young couple, they're the first off the floor, and then everybody that's been married a year, you got to leave, and then everybody 5 years, and then 10 years, and then 30 years, till finally there's only one couple left on the dance floor. This elderly couple had been married well over 50 years, and that was my mom and my dad. And my dad's this big, tall guy, 6'2", and my mom is about 5'1", you know, he's got white hair and she's got white hair. And it's so amazing to look at them, because when they look at each other, like, no time has passed from when they got married. And in my mom's eyes, he's still that young, tan tennis champion that he was 60 years ago. And she still is that lovely, beautiful, lively belle that she was. And it's just like this. And now my dad's just, we'll be celebrating his 80th birthday real shortly. And I looked over at Courtney and her husband, and I thought, it's just going to be like that. and it will be another 53 years. And they will be the old couple on the floor. And in 53 years, my mom will be gone. And my dad will be gone. My wife will be gone. I'll be 110 years old. Paul says, redeem the time, for the days are evil. And eternity is in session. And the greatest offer that's ever been given to the human race is this gospel, this good news of Jesus. And it is that up there is coming down here. And guys, if you're at a church, that's part of the cause that you help to lead. And you understand, every time that somebody's got resources and instead of hoarding them, they get generous, up there's coming down here. Every time there's a relationship and it would be broken, but instead somebody speaks words of reconciliation, then up there's coming down here. Every time there's this racial chasm in a society and somebody, instead of speaking words of hate, speaks words of truth in love, then up there's coming down here. Happens all the time, and you get to be a part of that, and I do too. And it starts in here, and then it goes beyond us. What if up there were to come down here in Malibu, California? In your church, wherever it is, that's the gospel. That's the good news of Jesus, and you get to be a steward of that. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the Bible. How guilty all of us so often are, God, of either misunderstanding or simply not taking it seriously, not thinking about it deeply, not seeking to understand it and setting it alongside of all of the other offers of wisdom given to the human race, just with open hands, open hearts, no pressure to see where does wisdom lie. Thank you for this man, Jesus, God, from whom our world has not yet recovered. Thank you for this vision of the value of a human life and of the possibility of the transformation of wills and minds and bodies, so that people can become conduits of life from far beyond ourselves. May it be so. May you make it so. God, teach us to pray. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. God, may your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. In Jesus' name, amen.